in week three of this sermon series on prayer and practice. The sermon series has been based patterned around the Lord's Prayer, taught by Jesus when asked how to pray. Week one was based on the first part of the Lord's Prayer, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, about the topic of praise. Last week was Give Us This Day, Our Daily Bread. And this week, we'll be touching on the topic of forgiveness. In addition, the purpose of this sermon series is to give you and the congregation new practices to take home and incorporate in your personal prayer lives. With that in mind, I'd like to start with our practice for this week, and then move into the theory behind it. This week's practice is meditative prayer. We live in a very big, very complicated world, a world where there's a million things demanding your attention all the time. Who here has a cell phone? Who here has their phone on right now? Who here's phone is on right now? There's nothing wrong with it. Mine's on. I'm not expecting a call, but I'm leaving my phone on just in case. And that's just one example. There's a million different videos on YouTube, hundreds of different channels on TV. We live in a world where there's more than one 24-hour news service. At any moment, the day or night, there are hundreds of things happening, and every one of them needs, demands your attention. And that's why meditation is so important, now more than ever. To be able to block out the millions of things and focus on what's most important. When Jesus was asked how to pray, what was the first thing he said to do? To get down on your knees? To close your eyes? No. The first thing to do when you pray, according to Jesus, was go into your room and close the door. Get away from the world, away from the things, the noise, everything that needs your attention. Close the door on it. And just for a little while, be alone with yourself, alone with your thoughts, alone with God. And that's what I'm asking you to try to do this week. Take 10 minutes. Leave your phone outside the door. Sit in some place comfortable, but not too comfortable. And focus. Try to clear your mind of those millions of little things. In certain Eastern traditions, when one meditates, we know the idea of humming, that they believe the sound of the universe at peace. A practical benefit of this humming while meditating is it gives you something to focus on. As soon as you recognize you're thinking about something other than your humming, you know that you're getting off track, and it gives you the opportunity to focus again. Personally, when I meditate at school, I do it silently by focusing on my breath. But I want to add something to that for this specific prayer practice. In your bulletins, there's that tan handout we were probably looking at a few minutes ago. On top was our memory verse, and on bottom was a prayer. It's the Jesus Prayer. Some of you are probably familiar with this prayer. Jesus, Savior, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. When you're taking your time to meditate this week, I would ask that you say this prayer. Say it over and over again. As soon as you finish, start over again. Jesus, Savior, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus, Savior, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. This is your thing to focus on. After a few repetitions, you'll notice that your breathing syncs up with the prayer. And after 10 minutes, you'll find yourself very calm. Now, you might ask, why this prayer specifically? And that's because this week's topic is forgiveness. I'm a seminarian. I am going to an institution of higher learning to pursue an advanced postgraduate degree in theology. theology. The general expectation is that most people will not be pursuing an advanced postgraduate degree in theology. Most people get their theology, learn their theology, and learn doctrine through church prayer. And through this prayer, I want to help you learn the theology of forgiveness. Forgiveness is very important to us as a Christian community. And we believe that sins are forgiven, but we still need to ask for forgiveness. In this church, we don't have the tradition of confession. That is to say, once a month, you don't sit in a tiny booth with someone else and say, here are my sins, here's what I have done. In the mountain preaching tradition, we don't have the practice of vocalizing aloud our sins together so that ours are lost in the noise. Instead, every month we say a collective confession. Lord, we have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. But when you're confessing as a community, you form a relationship with God as a community, and not a personal one. It's so that you don't know God, but you know of him. And we believe in a God that is personally in touch with each of our lives, that knows each intimate detail about us, not as a group, but as individuals. Now, after we say this group confession, there is a time where we're given the possibility of confessing our sins in our hearts, silently. And I can't speak for any of you, but I know that when I'm doing this practice, by the time the pastor gets up and says, in the name of Christ, you are forgiven, I'm not even halfway down the list. I haven't gotten to the point where I say, Lord, forgive me, and yet I'm already forgiven. And if I don't get to ask for that forgiveness, but this is the only time we do this practice of confession, when will I? I'll never get around to asking for forgiveness. And it's in the Apostles' Creed. We believe in the forgiveness of sins. So we start taking that for granted. We immediately decide, my sins are forgiven. So, why should I ask them to be forgiven? It's already done. And as soon as we stop wondering why we should ask for forgiveness, that's when we stop forgiving others. Under that same assumption, their sins are already forgiven, so what's the point? This semester, I'm taking a course, a study in the Epistle to the Romans through the Partnership of Religion and Education in Prisons program. And through this program, I've met a wonderful modern American theologian named Willie. Willie is on the inside, and the first time I met him, he told me about a book he's writing that touches on this topic of needing to ask for forgiveness. Willie calls this sinstitutionalization. The world we live in is inherently sinful. And as members of this sinful world, we have sin. And as soon as we forget it, as soon as we stop recognizing that sin as sin, when we stop thinking of ourselves as sinners, that's when we get into trouble. And that's why I'm asking you to pray the Jesus Prayer. Jesus, Savior, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Because if you don't acknowledge your own sin, how can you ever be free of it? And once you have acknowledged it, once you've accepted it, being free of it is that much sweeter. And so, again, I ask you all to pray. Jesus, Savior, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Thank you.